What's up, guys? The Gilbert Burns and Sean Brady Fight Night card just wrapped up, and it was pretty decent. I'll give it like a 7 out of 10 Fight Night card. Some good fights, some good performances, some good finishes. Gilbert Burns is washed. Sean Brady is better than ever. Both can exist at the same time. Usually when someone says that a fighter is washed, they think it means like the other fighter just isn't as good or something like that. No, Burns is clearly not the same fighter anymore. He's 38 years old, and it looked like he was 38 years old. He looks slower, an overhand merchant, but his grappling was on point. Very good reversals. Sean Brady's boxing improved dramatically. Much better footwork, good grappling. Like, he looks like a top five fighter 100%. And had good cardio too. He's never been five rounds before. Natalia Silva has to become the champion. She's got to become the face of women's MMA for multiple reasons. She's one of the most exciting fighters in the female divisions. Steve Garcia is a monster. I've been telling people about this guy. He is amazing, man. I've been on his hype train for about two fights now, which isn't that long. Yanel Ashmal's made a Trevor Peak fight boring, which is insane. And on my predictions, I did get most of the fights correct, but the ones I got incorrect was the Sean Brady-Gilbert Burns fight. I did pick Burns. I didn't expect him to look as slow as he did, and I didn't expect Sean Brady's boxing to look as good as it did. So, main event, I did get incorrect. The Peak and Ashmal's fight, I thought Peak was probably going to win. The Zhurong and Chris Badilla fight, and the first fight on the card. Nathan Fletcher defeated Ziggy Romaska. Is that 8 correct and 4 incorrect or something like that? Yeah, 8 correct, 4 incorrect. Pretty decent, I guess. But let's start with the main event. Sean Brady defeats Gilbert Burns by a decision. He looked amazing. Sean Brady, I did not expect his boxing to look as good as it did. I mean, this is the same guy who got TKO'd on the feet by Bilal Muhammad. How good is Bilal Muhammad? Like, Brady's boxing is not bad. He has some good angles off his punches, good combinations, fought very well off the jab, good footwork, and Bilal steamrolled him. But at the same time, Gilbert Burns only throwing overhands, much slower than ever before. He was clearly not the same fighter. And Burns is not an overhand merchant. If you've watched his fight with Alexei Kuchenko, which is still the best striking display in Gilbert Burns' entire career, when you look at him fight even Khamzat, the wildness of that brawl, he wasn't just throwing overhands. He knocked out Damian Maia with a clean left hook, very fast. Burns has never been just an overhand merchant. One of the few times we've seen him only throwing that kind of punch. And it wasn't even fast. Like, you look at the difference of the speed that Burns fought with when he fought Khamzat, right? Night and day with the speed that Burns was fighting Sean Brady with. Like, there's a drastic difference with the way that he fought JDM versus the way that he fought Sean Brady. Like, even a fight ago, he doesn't look like the same fighter anymore. Which is crazy to see a fighter just, like, get hit by Father Time out of nowhere like that. I mean, it's not out of nowhere. He is old, but to see that drastic of a difference in Gilbert Burns is kind of crazy because he looked way better when he fought Jack Della. And also that weird extended guard that he had, almost like John Jones does. Lee hand extended forward, moving away from the opponent and the right hand blocking one side. Gilbert Burns doesn't have the reach for that to work. He has like a 71 inch reach. That kind of guard works for John Jones, who has an 84 inch reach. Or if Adesanya uses that guard, or Sergey Pavlovich, like fighters with that kind of arm span, the extended guard is perfect for them. But Burns was getting hit every time he did that. Sean Brady was hitting with uppercuts. He was landing overhands all over the guard and stuff. Like, and he kept defending that same way. Even just covering up when Sean Brady wasn't even throwing 100% power punches at him. He was just touching him, went for the takedown, got into the clinch, all that stuff. And for the majority of the first two rounds, it was just a clinch fest. I think it was like 8 or 9 minutes into the fight. About 6 of those minutes were in the clinch when they had the stats up of clinch control time. And Sean Brady's wrestling looked really good. His takedowns were on point. Burns had a really good ability to reverse them. I mean, he was reversing most of the takedowns. And then even getting his own single leg off of that reversal. Like, Burns' grappling is very, very high level. And he showed why opponents don't want to take him to the ground. And Sean Brady's one of the best grapplers in the division, too. If you're not Damian Maia, you're not really gonna submit Gilbert Burns or get him in some dominant position or something like that, you know? And also, Burns had very high level low blows. A lot of kicks down there were very powerful. Sean Brady took off, like, what, 3 minutes of the fight recovering? And that could be another reason as to why his cardio did look really good. I mean, he had so much time to just rest and recover. But that's because Gilbert Burns kept lifting that left foot up and hitting Sean Brady low. He did that twice, almost the exact same move too. But amazing performance by Sean Brady. He looked really good out there, and he called out Ian Garry. Respect to that, because they're both under the same manager, and most fighters don't want to fight others who have the same manager. So we'll love to see that fight. I think Sean Brady beats him. Ian Garry is not grappling with Sean Brady. And even in the stand-up, Brady can land some good punches on Ian Garry. So I think Brady should win that fight, and then one more and he gets a title shot. But it depends if he gets Ian Garry. What if he fights Jack Della Maddalena? That would be a really good fight too. But I really want to see Jack Della fight Kamaru Usman. And now that Jorge Masvidal's back, he wants to fight Leon Edwards, which is a fight they can do. I mean, I'm pretty sure Leon wants to fight Jorge too. Even though Jorge's not ranked, he lost to Gilbert Burns in his last UFC fight. I don't think he deserves to fight Leon Edwards, but at the same time, he's big enough of a star. And there is a bit of a storyline with him and Leon. That fight does make sense, especially now that welterweight doesn't have a big star. Jorge will be the biggest star at welterweight when he comes back. That's how much this division needs a star. We'll see what Bilal Muhammad, he's only had one title fight. Maybe if he goes on a long win streak, he can develop a bit of star power. Get a lot of people behind him with that. But Sean Brady versus Ian Garry is a pretty good fight if Jorge is fighting Leon. That could leave Usman to fight JDM and then Shavkat to fight Bilal. And as for Gilbert Burns, I mean, have him fight Michael Venom Page or Carlos Prates, someone like that. Those would be really interesting fights. And then we go to the co-main event. Natalia Silva outclassed Jessica Andrade for 3 rounds. Distance management on point, footwork skills, non-stop output of strikes and clinches, cardio for days, trading shots with a power puncher, orthodox southpaw, fought the same way, combinations ending on the same side, leaning back like Adesanya, countering with the hooks, which will not work against Alexa Grasso. Grasso will land straight punches, kind of how Strickland landed on Adesanya. And Grasso has a very good one too. But Natalia also showing a great chin, smiling after taking Andrade's best punches like they're nothing. Remember that one sidekick launching Jessica Andrade across the octagon? Stunned Andrade with that one left hook to the eyes. She was throwing some kicks on that side, but she started throwing a lot more kicks to the other side where the eye wasn't damaged. And the spinning kicks to the body, some were landing, some were missing, but the one to the head. I was expecting a lot more spinning kicks to the head from her, but I know that she was expecting Jessica Andrade to get under those, go for the single leg high cross, take her down. But the takedown defense was on point, man. Natalia Silva is a future champion and looking amazing doing it in every way. Absolutely beautiful post-fight interview and condolences to her family. She said that she lost her sister 4 months ago and she was implying that it was like something to do with substances, you know. I wish her and her family the best. Prayers out to her sister. And Grasso is amazing, but Silva needs to become the face of women's MMA. She is by far my favorite female fighter to watch. And who should she fight next? The next fight for Natalia Silva should be against the winner of Rose Namajunas versus Erin Blanchfield. A fight between her and Namajunas would be really cool. And as for Jessica Andrade, she's in 2 weight classes, so it just depends on which one she wants to fight at, but she's fought pretty much everybody. I wouldn't mind seeing her fight Tracy Cortez or Vivian Araujo or something like that. And then the mean machine, Steve Garcia, wiping out Kyle Nelson as soon as he got out of the back take. Two hands on one arm, spun out when Kyle Nelson had his back, and just laid the hammer fist to defend the armbar. This guy punched his way out of a submission, and every paused elbow rocked Nelson. The first elbow landed behind the ear, leaving a hematoma so you could see where the elbow landed. Then the other one landed on the temple, rocking Kyle Nelson again, finish him off a ground and pound. And it's crazy because all of that damage came off of a reversal on the ground. He didn't rock Kyle Nelson on the feet, then finish him with ground and pound, which you usually see. You don't often see a lot of fighters cause all the damage on the opponent on the ground, where they didn't try to grapple in the first place. Steve Garcia has to fight a top 15 fighter, and him versus Sadiq Youssef would be pretty cool. I think Garcia TKOs him. And Kyle Nelson versus Mike Davis would be pretty cool as well. Then what about Cody Durden? Ninja chokes Matt Schnell in the second round. This fight was crazy. The trades on the feet were insane. Durden was ducking inward with hooks and that right overhand, which was landing a couple times. You could see the blemish on Schnell's eye. But then Schnell started to counter with uppercuts, leaning away from some of those right overhands. And his chin actually looked pretty decent in this fight. But it was because he saw the punches. But then he shot a takedown from way too far, and Durden snatched up that neck like a ninja, tapping out Matt Schnell. And I think Schnell retired after that fight. I mean, he is like, what, 34, 35 years old? He did lose to the best fighters in the flyweight division, but Cody Durden choking him like that is probably the end of Matt Schnell's title aspirations. Let's do Cody Durden versus Tim Elliott, or you could do Cody Durden versus Manel Kep. Those would be really good fights. And then Yanel Ashmos defeating Trevor Peak by a unanimous decision, but 30-27 is ridiculous. I thought Peak won the second round, and he nearly won the third round as well. He was landing big shots, but was clipped with a left hook, his hands down, chin up, but durable as ever to take a clean shot like that and keep swinging, because Ashmos, he punches really hard. So for Peak to take a punch like that and just keep going forward, caveman style, is crazy. But Ashmos did make the fight boring, so cut him. If a fighter makes a Trevor Peak fight boring, even if they win, they should get cut from the UFC. No, I'm kidding. Ashmos did fight smart. He was defensive until Peak started to caveman swing. Clinches and counter hooks were there for Ashmos, but Peak did tone down a bit of the wildness. He was still very wild, but Peak a few fights ago was different kinds of wild. So Trevor Peak is getting more technical, but you know, Oshmos won the fight. There was way too much clinching there and in the main event. There was so much clinching. Good win for Oshmos though. What about Chris Badilla defeating Zhu Rong by a TKO doctor stoppage in the second round? Landed that perfect elbow to the eye that just ballooned that side of his face. His eye looked like there was something trying to crawl out of it. And the way that exchange worked was actually kind of interesting. So Zhu Rong was entering with a jab, but at the same time, Chris Badilla, when he was rotating that right elbow, his arm knocked down the jab, landing to the eye end. And Badilla said in the press conference that he felt something mush when he landed that elbow. He felt his eye mush? Oh, I hope Zhu Rong's okay, man. I hope his eye's able to recover. Isaac Dolgarian, like, do we even have to talk about this fight? Brendan Morad is just not UFC caliber. Complete grappling domination, choked him out with the arm triangle, and then did the leprechaun dance. I don't know what that was. Andre Lima defeating Felipe Dos Santos by a decision. This was a really good fight, but it isn't an Andre Lima fight without some kind of foul in the cage. And in this fight, Andre Lima grabbing the fence. It seems like in every fight he's in, there's some kind of biting, fence grabbing, something like that going on in his fights, whether it's him or his opponent, because he's a very good fighter. His technique was on point, very good counter punches, walking down Felipe, even got a body lock takedown at one point. Felipe was a little bit more wild with some of his overhands. He had good kicks out there, pretty decent in the clinch, but Andre Lima was just the superior striker overall, way more confidence in his ability to defend shots and counter. I think he's going to be maybe a top 10, top 5 contender. And it's crazy with Felipe Dos Santos. He's a guy who went toe-to-toe with Manel Kep and now is on a 2-loss streak. A lot of people thought after the Kep fight that he's going to be some kind of future contender, but sometimes it's just that short notice opponent against the ranked UFC fighter. We saw that with Tony Ferguson versus Lando Venata, and it looks like maybe Felipe Dos Santos was Manel Kep's Lando Venata. Gabriel Santos putting on a performance against Yizia, striking on point, grappling on point, rocking him with the front kick to the face after conditioning him with the switch front kick earlier, defending very well-timed takedowns by Yizia, and even getting takedowns of his own. Gabriel Santos is probably going to be a very good fighter in this featherweight division in the future. I'm thinking top 15 at least. And just to put it into perspective, if you put Gabriel Santos into the light heavyweight division, he's probably like a top 5 fighter. Like, Gabriel Santos is a much better fighter than Jamal Hill. Bit of a non sequitur, I guess, or not really too relevant, but it just shows you how good featherweight is. Like, he's a perfect example of a non-ranked fighter in one of the lower weight classes compared to some of the best fighters in the heavier weight classes. If Jamal Hill and Gabriel Santos fought each other in a size parity fight, Gabriel Santos is destroying Jamal Hill. That's how good this guy is. And that's how good the smaller weight classes are in general. Jacqueline Amarim submitting Vanessa Demopoulos very easily, but she did do it with a glove grab. And I think regardless, she was going to win this fight. I mean, she clearly grabbed a glove in order to get that armbar, but Demopoulos threw a leg kick like 20 seconds into the fight. Amarim took her down and immediately got into side control. She nearly got full mount. She got her back. I mean, it was just a complete mismatch when it came to the grappling. And man, were some of those positions very distracting. I'm trying to focus on the grip, but the cameraman, he knows what he's doing. Because of this cameraman, makes me have to replay some of these sequences over and over and over again. And I enjoyed it every time. Great performance by Amarim, but glove grab. And we're not talking about Andre Petrosky and Dillian Budka. We need that Men in Black memory erase thing for that fight. Petrosky won by a decision. It was a lay and pray, just snooze fest. And Budka cut so much weight for the fight. I expected Petrosky to have a much better performance than that. But Nathan Fletcher submitted Ziggy Ramoska. Fletcher took the fight to the ground immediately. Ramoska got him in a guillotine, then an inverted triangle choke. I mean, that was surprising to see Ramoska grapple that well in the first round with someone like Fletcher too. But got full mounted at the end of the round. Body lock takedown in the second round, got easy full mount. I mean, Ramoska just regressed so much in the second round. Hit bump Fletcher into an arm triangle choke, and then easy submission win for Fletcher. So it was a pretty decent fight night card, and I hope you guys enjoy the fights as well. What was your favorite fight, favorite finish, favorite fighter on the card? And I'll see you guys in the next video.